Hello, my name is Antti Rasila, and I'm working the quantum technion, which is the Chinese branch of the Technion Israel Institute of Technology, as a mass associate professor in our mathematics with computer science program. And my title is Numerical Computation of Harmonic and Quasiconformal Mappings, and this is joint work with Gerhard Opfer from the Technion main campus in Haifa, and my student, our joint student, Terry Wayne Wallace, who is studying for master degree here in the quantum technion. And abstract is here. So we discuss numerical computation of harmonic and quasi-conformal mappings, which are natural generalizations of conformal mappings. And in particular, we will discuss an algorithm which is done by Opfer, and later further developed and generalized by Bshouty and Hengartner. This allows numerical computation of univalent harmonic mappings onto starlike domains. And we will discuss basically Mathematica implementation of this algorithm. So that is the main topic. And this computational work here has been done by our student Wallace. Background here is that this Opfer developed the method for constructing conformal mappings from the unit disk onto star-like domains using extremal properties of conformal mappings. And this method, of course, has limitations. This that the domain is star-like is quite limiting, but on the other hand, it also generalizes for harmonic mappings, which is a more general class of functions than conformal mappings, and we will implement this refined version here and see some numerical example how it goes on. And let's a little bit take a look background of this theory first. So what are conformal, harmonic, and quasi-conformal mappings? So conformal mappings are characterized by the property that they preserve angles between two smooth curves at their point of intersection. So the idea here is that you have two curves and then they intersect at some point, and then there is a tangential lines of these curves because they are smooth curves. Tangential lines are defined and they have some kind of angle. And then we will take a mapping which can be understood as some kind of map projection, which maps these curves onto some other plane, like let's say, which can be understood as some kind of map of this region, and the angle is the same. And typically, when you are studying this, you would plot a rectangular grid or some kind of, or a polar grid, some kind of grid where the grid lines are orthogonal onto some kind of grid, and conformal mappings would remain this property that these grid lines are orthogonal, but they are not lines or circles anymore, they are something else. And this is something which has been studied for several hundred years in cartography, and it is also a phenomenon which naturally occurs in many physical examples, like, for example, things which are related to heat transfer and some electric fields and many kinds of physical phenomena. So this is a relatively natural concept, although it might sound a little bit abstracted here. And indeed, in Mathematica, it's possible to draw conformal mappings if you have the formula for the mappings. It is easy to draw this image of the unit disk or something in that mapping. But the problem here is that conformal mappings, although they are plenty, so for example, simply connected domain which has just one boundary component, which is not the whole complex plane. It can be by Riemann mapping theorem mapped conformally onto the unit disk. However, this mapping is usually difficult to obtain, and it requires some advanced numerical method. It is not so that you can easily derive it by pen and paper calculations or even by simple algebra. And there are many different methods. In this presentation, I will discuss only two methods, but there are more than 10 different methods known for computing conformal mappings numerically onto usually from the unit disk to the given domain. And also they can be studied on surfaces, like for example, if you draw a map of the globe, or which is understood as an ellipsoid, or you can of course think about the potato shaped asteroid, or even the conformal mapping of the human brain, and all these have applications. In the complex plane, when you are studying conformal mappings, you have a nice characterization by the Cauchy-Riemann equation. So it's a system of partial differential equations related to the component functions of this complex valued function. It's real and imaginary part, in other words. And you can not insist these Cauchy-Riemann equations. You just require that these really imaginary parts are solutions of the Laplace equation. Laplace of U and Laplace of V is equal to zero. And then you will get another class of mappings, which are called harmonic mappings. And we may relax these conditions also from a geometric point of view and say that these angles are allowed to distort a little bit, but not too much, and then you will get quasi-conformal mappings. And you can also take harmonic mapping of the class of mappings, which is both harmonic and quasi-conformal, which has been also studied a lot in mathematics. But this kind of more relaxed classes of mappings have their own set of applications, and they are interesting in some context also. Okay, and let's discuss about a little bit about this algorithm of Opfer and its generalization. So we say that the domain omega is called a star-like with respect of the origin. If you have a line which starts from the origin and then it's a straight line through the origin. And if you think about it as a kind of half line, which has this endpoint at the origin, and it goes to infinity, it touches the boundary of this domain only at one point. That is the idea of star likeness. And it might, for example, look like this. So this is a very natural definition. And this star likeness is understood as some kind of a generalization of convexity in some sense. So, for example, convex domains contain the origin star-like with respect of origin, obviously. And this algorithm here approximates a harmonic mapping from the unit disk onto this given star-like domain, and it determines behavior of the entire region by only using calculations on the boundary. So interesting property of these conformal mappings is that they are somehow fixed by the boundary, but there are also ways of studying them without studying the boundary. So in some sense, you can study them locally within the domain, but you can also study them only on the boundary and don't care about the domain. And this is what happens inside the domain, and this is rather interesting that these two seemingly very different types of problems are so closely connected. And this algorithm works by minimizing a particular subnorm or a particular affine space to approximate the harmonic function, which is in our example case, it's just a conformal mapping. And here there is the Minkowski functional and the subnorm, and this is this new omega given here, and it is infimum of positive lambdas such that this is this z over lambda is in the domain. And this obviously depends then on the domain. And this gives you a vector, or you have here a complex number z, which is understood in with respect of this in as just some kind of vector, and this lambda is a scalar real number. But this z is a complex number or a vector of length 2. They are seen at from the point of view of this kind of analysis the same thing. And mu is this is the looks for largest Minkowski functional on the set E. And then you will think that if you think of this D as the unit disk, then we will minimize this affine this subnorm over some particular affine space, which is generated as follows. So this is generated recursively in this sense that we will take double do not to be one and W1 to be the imaginary unit, and then we will make the even indices. They are developed from this in some sense, so that we will take this kind of complex integral here, and then these imaginary units, or these are multiplied by the imaginary unit, and we will form this kind of a number by complex integration. And now here is the affine space denoted Vn, and it is developed by this. And details what this means can be found from this paper. I don't have time to here to go through all details, but these papers are available, and we can, and of course you can write me and ask if you want to something to know something more. And the algorithm here is that we will take sample points from the boundary of the unit disk, which are called Xj, and the solution of the problem minimizes this subnorm over this affine space. And this minimum finding here can be done by using Mathematica built-in functions. So here is the Minkowski functional, and these are real variables which are solved by the program, which we have implemented for this purpose. And what does it look like? Well, here we have this flower type domain, or you can think it as some kind of biscuit. To me, it looks a lot like this kind of traditional Finnish gingerbread. And you will, and this is our star-like domain, and we want to approximate this conformal mapping here. And although this problem does not look very impressive, I think that actually it is somehow a good benchmark problem, because this computation is not easy. It might look that it's very easy to approximate this kind of thing, but not all algorithms will deal with this domain well, because the boundary is not polygonal. And for this reason, those which require some kind of broken line approximation of the domain, for example, will not do particularly well with this, unless you will take huge number of sample points, which will make the algorithm slow and cause errors in computations. Okay, and then we will set up this function in this case, and it has formula for each this Vn, and here are the formulas which are given, and these are real variables which are solved by the programs, and these are the points sampled on the boundary of the unit disk. And then what does this program do? It uses Mathematica n-minimize function to determine this solution, which is obtained here. And this function is found by this process approximating the desired conformal mapping or harmonic mapping more generally, but in this simple example, we just had a conformal mapping. And what do we get out of this? Well, we get an example, which is the solution on the boundary. And the function generated by this algorithm, and these are the sample points we use here. And then we will try to work on this. And here is the conformal mapping, and you can see what are the images of the grid lines. So apparently, this is already, of course, you could just keep computing and get much more beautiful picture, but even a simple application of this algorithm lets you plot the conformal mapping. And this is work in process, so we are trying to further develop these algorithms in order to get better and more and results, but nevertheless, already this algorithm at least is relatively easy to implement with Mathematica, and it can be actually computed. So in this sense, this at least shows that this algorithm is theoretically useful. And here is another example. This is again a very simple one, but you might think that finding conformal mappings from a disk to an ellipse is rather simple, but that is not the case. There is an analytic formula which has been published not so long time ago, a couple of years ago, published in a relatively good journal, and it is developed by using some elliptic integrals, and it has a very complicated formula. Of course, if you just want the function to be harmonic, then you could use affine mapping of the plane. You could use just this kind of a mapping which stretches to the directions of the coordinate axis. But in this case, if you want to set the dilatation so that the mapping is conformal, there is an analytic formula, but it is not easy. However, this one can do it numerically in the relatively easily, and we have now approximated this mapping here, and this is in the so this is the these are the sample points, and then we will get this result here onto this kind of domain. Okay, so this was another example. So this is it appears that this algorithm, this paper one, is relatively straightforward to implement in Mathematica, and it's not completely clear what are the specific advantages of this method, but we are now working to do further theoretical approach, further theoretical research on this topic, and at least is somewhat promising that this algorithm we are using as the starting point can be implemented, and it seemingly works. And this method does not require approximation of this boundary by polygonal elements, but it does require star-likeness, and it's not completely clear if this requirement can be relaxed, but it seems possible that it is indeed doable. And for example, this might be developed for doubly connected domains by using some ideas of our recent theoretical work dealing with another topic. And I should mention, because these examples were rather simple and perhaps you are not impressed, we did actually quite a lot of work also by using Mathematica for a different kind of method, which is called the conjugate function method. And we obtained them by in this paper, which is in the list of references. And this is based on solving these real and imaginary parts of the mapping separately. So they are called U and V. And they're both solutions to this Laplace equation that they satisfy Laplace of U and Laplace of V is equal to zero. So they are harmonic functions. However, the thing here is that you can actually solve these separately by using variational methods, and they obtain these functions. But in order to satisfy the Cauchy-Riemann equations, you have to find this kind of constant multiplier H, which is the so-called conformal modulus of this domain, and it defines the conformal equivalence class of these domains. And once you fix the four points on the boundary. And this method is somewhat, somewhat neat. And you can also play with other values and obtain quasi-conformal mappings. And this is one topic we are now working with, because these quasi-conformal mappings have some recent interesting applications. And the advantage of this method is this is relatively easy to program, but on the other hand, it requires solving some kind of mixed boundary value problem on the boundary of the domain. And we did it in this paper 2 and 3, which are mentioned here in the references. We did it by using HP finite element method, HP adaptive finite element method, which both refines the grid and it increases the polynomial order of the approximate of this basis functions, and this of these elements, and this is a quite advanced method, but we did obtain really beautiful results, and I will show you a couple of these. So these are perhaps more impressive looking pictures. So here is this same biscuit shaped domain or flower shaped domain which we studied there, and you can see that this grid is really refined, so we were able to do it quite in much precision. And the goal of this research, one of the goals of the research, would be to refine this method which we implemented in this simple example in order to get something of this quality. And furthermore, we did doubly and multiply connected domains, and we generalized it in this 3 to multiply connected domains. This paper 2 just dealt with simply connected simply and doubly connected domains. And here should be noted that this is a zero angle. And this zero angle is very hard for different kinds of methods, but for this method, it is not hard at all, because this HP adaptive finite element method can handle this with ease. And this work with multiple connected domains is, I think, rather advanced, and it was just published a little more than a year ago in SIAM Journal of Scientific Computing. But this algorithm is easy to program if you use Mathematica built-in finite element solver, and you can actually compute these potential functions and this conformal modulus relatively easily for simple domains, by using built-in functions, it's just a couple of lines of code, the whole thing. But if you want this kind of complicated geometries, and then this Harri Hakula has implemented this HP adaptive finite element solver in Mathematica also, which is of course for this kind of complicated applications much superior to the built-in functions. And here are our references. So this starts with this Opfer and the new extremal properties for constructing conformal mappings, Numerische Mathematik, in this is a top journal, but of course long time ago. And then he continued conformal mappings on the prescribed regions via optimization techniques, also Numerische Mathematik. And almost 10 years later, this was studied by Bshouty, the collaborator here, and Hengartner, father and son, a constructive method for star-like harmonic mappings. This was also published in Numerische Mathematik. And then this mentioned what I mentioned as more like my line of research was these two papers here, conjugate function method for numerical conformal mappings with my colleague, former colleague Harri Hakulan, former PhD student Chi Quach. And here are two papers, and this generalization for multiply connected domains was really hard work. And if you are interested in applications of conformal mappings, they are now somehow popular for example, in cartography, which has become more and more important because of this GPS navigation and other modern applications. So this book is not really about advanced methods for conformal mappings, but but it connects these map projections and this kind of applications to this conformal mapping theory. So if you're interested about this topic and about cartography, this is, I think I would recommend this book by geodesy professor Martin Vermeer from Aalto University. And unfortunately, it's now 4 a.m. in China when this talk was scheduled to start, so I'm not able to be online in myself. But if you want to discuss about this topic or ask something, you have here a link for my research page. You can find link from this page, and there are my email addresses. So thank you for your attention, and let's be in touch by email or something if you want to know more. Thank you.